that had, through case law or by statute itself, which is only two states, decided to give priority to the factor, it was the same old, that is, we were still mostly primary caretaking was what mattered, except it didn't always, and you never knew when it wouldn't. So you'd get these cases where all of a sudden it was so important that the grandparents, who the kids were used to visiting every Sunday, you couldn't move away from them because that was an important relationship, or the mother was still living with her parents, sponging off of her parents. That meant she couldn't be very good for the kids. It wasn't a very good role model. Friendly parent, big, you know, where judges come to the point where they're saying, this is a really hard custody case, so let's just pick the parent who seems like they're going to be most encouraging of the other parent's relationship with the child. That's probably the biggest in these cases where I'm finding what I call outlier cases, cases where the primary caretaker is not winning. So I thought sort of at the last minute, well, I'll look at the two states that do have a priority, statutory priority, West Virginia, the whole ALI rule, and Oregon a little bit milder than that, and see if they're doing any better. And in fact, it does look like they're doing better. I don't find, there's a huge problem with researcher bias here, and I haven't done a randomized slice of the cases. I wish I had known what I was going to be doing when I started this paper, when I started reading cases, and had a social scientist working with me to see how to code these cases. The coding of these cases is just a monster of a job, because you have to figure out from looking at an appellate case, you're not going to go to the trial record each time, what's really making the difference here? Will the judge even articulate it? So I don't have a whole lot of, I don't know that I'd have a whole lot more if I had done something a little bit more social scientific. But what I'm finding in my anecdotal way is that West Virginia and Oregon do not have as many cases. Bob, this should be a good sign. And I'm struggling to find examples where they have out of nowhere decided to pick a factor that not necessarily unrelated to the child's welfare, but why pick that factor rather than something else? Just since I've distributed this paper, I decided, well, another thing I could do here is look at the state of Washington, because between 2000 and 2007, the state of Washington had passed caretaking as the factor that the court should give the greatest weight to, and figure out how that works out. So I'm going to play that out. I did find one case in that period that looked like it was sort of an example of my outlier cases. And it's true that, and there's not a whole lot of, although 2007 seems like a while ago, they're not actually, in terms of state Supreme Court cases, not many cases that have worked their way up there to which the later 2008 law applied. So my end there might not be big enough to support my hypothesis with anything from Washington, but it's at least an interesting thing to follow. It's always been the case that the primary caretaker usually gets custody, and I see nothing that's changed that, although I would love to have some recent statistics if anybody sort of knows anybody who's looking at that. But really, the there's a finding here. It's that it looks like, if you read enough cases, it looks like the addition of past caretaking itself is not going to do any, along with a whole long laundry list of factors, really doesn't seem to be making much of a difference. It really doesn't seem to be much of a difference. Again, I'd love to have better quantitative data, but as between a general do it to the best interest of the child versus a big long laundry list of factors, you know, both of those jurisdictions are producing these what we'll call unpredictable or idiosyncratic cases. The thing that I found most interesting, I'll point out because Nancy's next, right? Yeah, okay. Is that the area, so I looked, as you know, from at divorce custody, relocation, and third party de facto parenthood. And Relocation, I'm not sure there's any hope to make that more determinant, and lots of people have reached this conclusion. Even the ALI, unless there's somebody, one of the parents has had a significantly greater parenting role, it kind of throws up its hands and say, best, like Bob did in the article, best interest is really probably the best we can do. Interesting that in the de facto parenthood situation, the law has developed with a greater sense of the need for determinacy. And I mean, that's got to be because of the parental rights business, that particularly after Troxell, the courts have had to either find their wide open best interest standards unconstitutional or construe them in a way to take account of parental rights, which we've sort of gotten used to writing in a way that have some meat to them. You know, we're either talking about unfitness or some extraordinary circumstances, which cases have got, you know, some pretty good cases interpreting that. And so, of course, it's a very different situation with an explanation and a distinction from the divorce custody situation, but it's got to be a little bit promising that we're able in the third party context to figure out who a parent is, and once we know who a parent is, we can pretty much tell, it varies state to state, but we can pretty much tell what's going to happen, right? Once we know that this person meets the criteria of a psychological parent or a de facto parent, whatever the state calls it, if that state recognizes that status, it seems to be easier to figure out what's going to happen than it does between parents. And so again, you would, on the one hand, expect that. On the other hand, is it possible from that determinacy to have some hope that maybe divorce custody could also be more determinant? Of course, Buffy and I think, yes, there is past caretaking. And it's not accidental that the de facto parent laws turn so heavily on past caretaking. There's all kinds of reasons, which I won't rehearse here, why that matters and why you might think that would be a good indicator of what you're looking for when you're trying to figure out what's best for children. So I'm going to stop there, Buffy, and turn this over to you.
Okay. So I was very heartened to read Kate's article and to see that in sort of interesting and subtle ways, it seems as though the focus on past caretaking, the approximation dimensions have started to have some influence. And I have just a few sort of random thoughts, some picking up on Bob's comments, but reactions to the paper. One thing that occurred to me in reading the paper is in thinking about the impact of the ALI custody provisions generally, is that there is a difference, I think, and I think you recognize this, between provisions that capture or reinforce a trend that already has some momentum. And I think that was happening with parenting plans and with domestic violence presumptions, that those were already sort of out there. They were getting attention. Some states had started to pass laws, and the ALI reinforced that, and coming from the ALI, I think increased the momentum toward the adoption of those kind of principles. Now, in contrast, the hard work of law reform in a setting where the proposed rule really is changing the law is hard work, and I think that's sort of the story with the approximation standard. And what you might predict is that the extent to which the task is difficult and progress is slow would at least have something to do with how closely the reform maps on to existing social and political norms. And to some extent, you'd think, well, that's true of the approximation standard. It is a good proxy for best interest. There certainly is widespread support for focusing on that in custody cases. But I think that the fathers' rights movement and their emphasis on shared parenting regardless of prior caretaking has really complicated that picture and has stalled any momentum toward adoption of the approximation standard. Now, the somewhat disappointing lack of progress in legislatures that we've seen in the approximation standard is pretty much what social scientists or political scientists would predict. And Bob sort of referred to this in his comments, that where you have two powerful interest groups contesting a legal reform, and one's in favor and one's opposed, it's not unusual for the legislature to just duck and let the sort of making of hard decisions and policy development, to the extent that it happens at all, happen below the radar screen by courts. And so keeping the broad standard in place is quite consistent with that. I mean, it's very interesting how easy it was to move from the tender years presumption to the best interest of the child standard with very little controversy. I mean, who could be against the best interest of the child? And yet the efforts to reform the law in the direction of joint custody have really been so much more contested. And so it's gratifying to me to see that there is action below the radar screen, and that at least some courts are prioritizing past caretaking, and that does have an effect on how decisions are made and increasing determinacy in the law. So a question that I have, and there's, you know, we don't have data on this, but it would be interesting to know more about the impact of a rule moving toward an emphasis on prior caretaking on bargaining outside of court. And I mean, that's always the interesting question, is what's the relationship between the legal rule and what families are deciding. And that, I think that would be pretty interesting in those jurisdictions that have emphasized past caretaking. So I've just one more comment, and this is a little bit sort of, I'm not sure it's very well formulated, but I as I was reading your description of the way in which a focus on past caretaking has been embraced in the formulation of rights for de facto parents, it occurred to me that here is a context in which these adults who have cared for children don't have rights, and they acquire rights by investing in their relationship with the children and by caring with the children. And that seems to me to have a kind of implication, at least indirectly, for the best interest standard. That to the extent that the factors other than, you can tell me this is all going to end up that we should all be in favor of past caretaking as the rule. But it seems to me that one way of understanding the best interest standard and the focus on many factors that don't have to do with caring for the child is that it provides a means for the parent who hasn't cared for the child to have a shot at getting custody in a world in which we're saying that both parents are equal, and maybe that's the point. So it may be that those other factors have more to do with parental rights than they have to do with the best interest of the child. So that's just a lot.
Well, that's great, thank you.
So I don't think there's any doubt that the father's rights message is, from a messaging standpoint, is simpler and more effective. It's because it's drawing on a very deep rooted, who could possibly oppose it, basic notion of equality. And it's the simpler of the available notions of equality. It's not the equality of equality based on like how much care you've provided. It's equality based on 50-50, no matter what. And that, I mean, it's a very simple, you know, we have much more complicated visions of equality than that, but this is the easiest to grasp. So we're not surprised that it has a lot of appeal among, it's been women's tool. So this part of the point of your paper, women would need to be using their own tools against themselves to make this sale. So that's really a big part of the problem. So one of the things I don't think I make clear in the paper or in the remarks I just made about courts and legislatures moving toward the approximation standard. So in statutorily, it's only West Virginia and Oregon. On top of that, there are dozens and dozens of cases that draw on the ALI principles, including the approximation standard, and they have great decisions. And I'm thinking, just as maybe the best example, the Hansen case from Iowa. Just a great, it just takes the rationale of the case, doesn't actually adopt the approximation standard because that's going to have to be left up to the legislature, but we're deciding this case based on these principles. And it's really a better, you know, it's as good a exegesis of the approximation standard as Buffy and I have written in our various ways. I mean, it's really quite powerful. But then thereafter, Iowa is full of cases that just decide on any which grounds in the most unpredictable kind of indeterminate way. So this makes this sort of thing very hard to measure and to chart. What is actually going on here? And you know, you could read this case every way to Sunday and read the next five cases that seem to ignore one of their Supreme Court cases and not know why the judge really decided this way. Is this as crazy as it looks, or was there something else going on he can't mention or she can't mention? You know, was there, you know, some other, that's what the nature of these cases is and why everybody thinks they can decide them based on their gut, and why as a researcher it's very difficult to get underneath the hood and find out what's really going on and try to measure it. So the long and the short of that is there is some appeal to this standard in some circles not represented in the actual statutes, but you never know when it's going to find its voice and when it will be ignored. I'd love to know about the impact of the rule on bargaining. I think we ought to commission Bob to do this work. So the last point about third, the last point that I was able to write down, this might not be the point you were making, but it's the point I thought of while you were making the point, so it might be your point. It might be your point and it might not be your point, but the strongest version of it is the third part, and we don't need to go there right away, but this makes Nancy's fact that her paper is following this one just seem like a stroke of genius. You started by saying the law evolving in the third-party parent context could have some spillover effect in how we think about best interests. But that's right. That's I'm going to say that in my paper, if you don't mind, because I think that's speculative, but pretty interesting thought. And then I wrote down, yeah, and constitutional rights too. And then I think you went ahead and said that, right? That we could, this after all, we do have. Is it Cabin or Caban? I never, you know, every year I pick something different when I'm teaching it. But that whole line of cases starting earlier than that, where basically unwed fathers, what it most turns on is what relationship they've been able to establish, which really means how much time and how much effort they've put into this relationship. There's no reason to think that the way third-party parent, for want of a better rubric here, law is developing could also informs best how we think about best interests and also informs the constitutional standards. And that was a question I had for you, actually, Emily, during whether you think there's any promise in that when you were giving your paper this morning, but we ran out of time. So let me open it up and get your thoughts. And are you going to do the study?
I'll tell you one comparatively easy way to do the study. I think what's interesting is not how many appellate cases there are, but you might be able to, in the states where there are a couple places where there is an approximation standard, try to get a measure of the number of contested cases where a court is really having to adjudicate it. Because I mean which if you want to know the bargaining effect, I mean, of course, a big question always is, I can argue it both ways, but a more determinate standard, the conventional wisdom is, it's got to reduce the number of contested cases, because why spend the transaction costs of going to court if your lawyer could predict with a high degree of certainty what the outcome is? And I think that's the primary effect. The secondary effect, though, in terms of negotiation, is to the extent there's a lot of uncertainty to this, if both parties are very risk averse, they may settle because they don't want to take the chance. I think the first effect is stronger than the second effect. I wanted to just make one additional observation that I meant to say before. The study that Eleanor Maccabee and I did, we asked fathers at time one, in your heart of hearts, what do you really want in terms of arrangements with your kids now that you're separated? And what was stunning is the proportion that said they wanted some kind of substantial involvement. So as an aspiration, you know, whether they called it joint physical custody or not, as an aspiration, it was very common. And I bet our study was done in the late 80s, came out in the early 90s. I bet 10 or 15 years earlier, it wouldn't have, percentages wouldn't have been the same. Mothers, of course, overwhelmingly said, no, you know, they typically wanted to approximate, okay? Now, what was fascinating, though, is huge, so you'd look at this data and you think, oh my God, we're heading for a terrible crack up because there are going to be 50 or 60% of all cases that are really contested. No. Because there's a big difference between the behavior of fathers and the behavior of mothers. Mothers acted on their expressed preference. Fathers didn't. And the number of fathers that said they wanted this, if you then ask, well, how many of them filed for it in terms of their response, a smaller percentage. And then if you asked how many of them later on in the process really pressed for it, much smaller percentage. So that in fact...
And then when they got it, gave it up.
Well, then when they got joint, I mean, that's the second point. And of course, everybody has acknowledged that now. What it says on the legal piece of paper and what's actually going on are often somewhat different. Second and last point. Our impression, strong impression, was if you looked at the most contested cases, and these were not simply the cases that the judge adjudicated, because in our study, you know, so few were adjudicated, you know, this is approximate 15 out of 1,000 that they didn't represent anything. But if you looked at the ones where we had other measures of how intense the conflict was, if you looked at cases where there was very intensive conflict, our strong impression was they were cases where a parent felt the other parent would endanger the child. Now, often they were a little, they might have been nuts in thinking it. Maybe they weren't nuts. I mean, we don't really have any way of knowing. But what really motivated, apart from probably some psychopaths, some fathers to persist, or what really motivated mothers to resist even labeling giving the father much involvement, was a fear that they really were going to somehow be harmful to the kids. And I think, last point, and this really goes to, you probably aren't giving yourself enough credit. I think the approximation standard, because the ALI has adopted it, has really had an impact. And if you want, what kind of impact? I think when people are talking to their lawyers, their mediators, whatever, about factors that are likely to weigh, I think the approximation factor is going to be very important. They're going to say, well, how, who has been doing one? The other thing is, and this is, I've never known quite how one would measure it, I believe the best predictor is what I call the status quo effect, which is almost the approximation effect. And that is, where, what is the custodial arrangement in terms of where you are in the process? And whatever that arrangement is, however you're dividing it in the interim, does the kid appear to be doing okay? And if the answer is yes, there's going to be great reluctance for any third party, reluctance, I'm not saying impossible, to push for a change. And so what that means is that what I really wonder is whether what people, this would be worth studying, what people agree to consensually, where they think it's just the short-term arrangement, may not have real carryover effects, particularly, you know, if there can't be later a showing that the kid is really being harmed by it very much. And I think the status quo effect generally, apart from the legal label, as we see, you know, 70% of cases.
Practicing attorneys will all say, it's all in the interim. It's all in the interim. That's what that's what the law is clearly not that.
No, it's the opposite.
It's the opposite, right? But you know, any family lawyer will say, you know, let's nail it. This is not a good time to turn your child over to your husband and go finish school. You're going to have to wait on that, and because it'll make all the difference in the world. Yeah.
Two thoughts, both of which Bob has touched on, so I'm bouncing off. I agree entirely that it would be very interesting to try to look at trial court filings, or to look at, there's data, negotiated custody arrangements, and see if they look any different in West Virginia and Oregon than they do in other places. I think that would be really telling and really interesting. And also a way to anticipate a concern that people might raise about relying on state high court decisions, because in most states, or at least in Maryland, the high court is the cert court, so they get to decide what cases they're going to take, and different courts, different judges have different views about, you know, whether they're interested in deciding certain cases. So there may be some real selection effects. And that's not through Maryland of the first level appellate court, the intermediate court. But the second was, as we've been talking about kind of fathers' rights groups and the gender politics, it struck me that there may be something else going on that we're not talking about. And this is based on my conversations with fathers' rights advocates, the ones who will talk to you, that there's an underlying something going on about unilateral divorce, that there is often the sense of, you know, she took my marriage away from me, or they, you know, took my marriage away from me, and they're not going to take my kids away. Mm-hmm. So the angriest, the strongest father's rights advocates that I know are the ones for whom the divorce was not their choice. And it made me really think of Bob's work and in renegotiating family relationships about the importance of, and the largely unacknowledged importance of, kind of the leaver and the leavee.
Right.
I don't know where to go with that, but that's definitely
totally
in there.
Right.
Totally right.
Do you want to, I'm over my head, do you want to respond to that?
Well, I mean, sure, I think it's, I mean, the way I sometimes think about it is, in the era of no-fault divorce, the contest gets shifted from who's at fault to who gets the kids, and that lots of, and it seems to be more dads, and I think there's reasons for that, they contest the end of the relationship by contesting custody. And I've certainly had of course, this is, I've tried to come up with a little data on that. If you think about it, that's a pretty provocative thing to say, right? You don't really want the kids, you're really trying to hang on to her, so trying to get data to that point isn't.
Or actually, I think here's a more empathetic reading.
that I was willing, within the marriage, I was willing to have, to take the role of the provider, you know. And that was a sacrifice, but I was willing to do it when we were married. Now you pulled the rug out from under me, and now I'm being penalized under the, you know, approximation approach for doing something, you know, that actually, you know, I made the choice for the good of the family, and now it's coming back to bite me.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
that's a good point.
Yeah,
I think that sounds just right.
But it's sympathetic.
No, it is sympathetic.
No, you see, and that really goes to the ambivalence point. Mm-hmm. It's not entirely crazy, because although we, no, the divorce now can be unilateral, it's not bilateral, unilateral, and it's no fault in that sense. It's not as if in terms of the couple,
there's no fault.
There's no fault. They won't perceive it in fault-based terms. Yeah. And you're, I think you're quite right in terms of asking what is triggering this anger. Particularly other parts of
the body. We heard a lot of that in the ALI deliberations. That certainly is what people feel and one source of resistance. You know, I guess I'm not as sympathetic to it as some of the head nodding here in this room. I've really tried hard not to defend past caretaking or approximation standard based on fairness between the parents. And I want that to work both ways. If it's right, it's not wrong because it's unfair, and it's not right because it's more fair. There's a certain, you know, if we're going to concede that what we're trying to do here is a rule that's best for the kids, I almost hesitate to use those words anymore because they're so question begging, which is the whole point of this conversation. So, you know, this must be one of the things you work on in mediation too, is how you get the parents to set aside, you have to recognize and then have them set aside their fundamental sense of having been abused, misfairly treated or cheated upon, or in this case, it being unfair. I signed on for one deal, you change the deal, you're leaving this relationship, and not only that, you're taking the advantage of your role, which was basically sitting around and watching the kid while I was really out there.
It's not sympathetic anymore.
This is a matter of therapy, right?
I think a way to keep it sympathetic, and I do think that's the argument that people make. But then I think they'll focus on the equal. And what I try to do both in mediation and in making the argument policy is that it's an old negotiation trick. I try to focus on interests instead of positions. Mm-hmm. And so what you're saying is you want to have a significant relationship. You want to acknowledge your importance to kids. Right. You don't want to be closed out of the child's life by, you know, your wife who left you and her new husband, you know. In an approximation rule, I try to argue, and in fact, on average, most dads are spending about a third of the time, and so you'd have something that really looked like joint physical custody anyway, even under the approximation rule, if you can get there. But so that's where I try to go. So what is the goal that you're trying to achieve, rather than what's the end result? You know, the position that you're beginning.
But I think it's got to be the case, certainly in the particular instances that I know, spokespeople for the father's right, not to condemn the entire movement, but spokespeople from the father's rights movement, they all have a story. They all have a divorce story that's where they have been badly treated.
So this is a very interesting discussion that makes me think about how this comes up when I teach this in class. So I teach primary caretaker, and then I teach the approximation standard. And it's all in the context of, is the best interest of the child a good idea? So the question is, the past caretaking standard or the primary caretaker standard, is it better than best interests because it is on its own better for children? Children should be with their primary caretaker, or most of the time, based on whoever most took care of them, because it protects their need for stability and continuity, and that person knows them the best. Is that the reason for it? Or is the reason for it that the best interest of the child standard in its indeterminacy is so inherently problematic that we would rather pick a more determinate standard because the ongoing litigation and conflict that best interest spawns is bad for children? And so this is good enough, and it achieves the benefit of eliminating indeterminacy. So how would you answer
that? Yeah, so it's mostly the first, but it's really both. About half of the papers for this conference make this point in one way or the other. The point is that and Emily said it first today, the best interest of the child, and actually Bob, you know, this is clear in your article, the best interest of the child standard is not in the best interests of children more generally, applying that standard, that aspiration, is not the best way to actually achieve the best interests of children. It's not because of the indeterminacy, because of the lack of social consensus, as Bob said earlier and does in his paper, and all those reasons that we know. So it's really hard for me to separate those two things, even though they are sort of analytically distinct.
I think you should try to separate them. I mean, I think it's a great question, but I thought the answer earlier was it's more the latter, which is to say, if you abstract what you're trying to get at, a standard that says just figure out what's best for kids is actually a better standard. But if you actually think about how it plays out, all the harm's done and all the ways it misfires, this is sort of, it approximates best interest, right? It's another kind of approximation. It gets close enough, it's a pretty good rough cut. And it takes you out of all those other harms. But I think if you try to sell it too much, you get a lot of legitimate objections of the sort that I said, among others, which is there are all kinds of reasons you might think that what you work out as a separate unit wouldn't by design be what would be best for kids, that what you'd work as a combined unit. But wow, trading off what you gain by staying away from this hazardous system, the best interest adjudication, it's a real selling point.
And that's pretty much the way I look at it as well, that the best interest of the child standard generates such costs as a rule for deciding custody that can we find a proxy that is the best available proxy that won't be resulting in good outcomes in every case, but it's the best proxy that I could come up with. I mean, that's the way I see it. And as so I see it as being a combination of those two.
The ALI, I meant to bring that thick book today in addition to the L&CP article, has six or eight safety valves, as you know. I mean, there are things that could be strong enough to overcome the presumption in favor of the approximation. And
do they make it sort of collapse?
Well, there's one that's clear harm to the child. Now, judges can do a lot with clear harm to the child.
It's been pretty, yeah. That distinction between best interest and harm findings.
Yeah,
it's
helped a lot. Yeah. It's helped a lot. Yeah, it hasn't. You know, in a way, there's no way to guard against some of what you read in these opinions, which is just flat out, I know what's best, and being able to find some way of making what I think I know is best be the rule. I mean, it's sort of like one of the things I put in the tail end of this paper is there's still a lot of playing around. Even we think that the past, who did the care of the pet past, it's a historical fact. It ought to be more easily determined by courts, as Bob said. You know, finding out what happened in the past is what courts do. It's a function that they are familiar with. I made this point a little bit earlier today, but that you still see a lot of playing around with the things that ought to be facts being very slippery, and including my favorite one, which I've got in the paper, is this woman somehow lost the advantage of being the primary caretaker because the father loved to take the kids out on the tractor on the farm. And I mean, that's really all there is in the opinion. But that negated, that balanced out past care. She was a stay-at-home mom, did everything for the kids, but they loved to go out on the tractor with their father. And that seemed to be all she wrote in that opinion. That's certainly all the judge wrote. So having a determinant standard, I guess this needs to be said in this conference, having a determinant standard in a field where all the other things we say are true about judges just knowing what the right thing to do is in a case, and with the absolute necessity of having some safety valves where you have people who really have no business, I know to be the case, severe mental illness and drug abuse and boyfriends who have convictions for child sexual abuse and so on. You have to have these safety valves, judges who are confident enough that they know what's best can find ways to use these, and there's just no getting around it.
You can't solve every problem.
Yes, just try to make it a little better. Other comments, questions? So let's reconvene at, what do you think, 10 of 1? People, 10 minutes?
10 of 2.
2.
10 of 2.